finish this excellent afternoon session, and maybe Lee is going to talk to us about combinatorial zeta analysis.
It's my great pleasure to attend this conference in honor of our Krishna Aradhi, and I'd like to thank the organizers for the invitation, and I wish Krishna happy birthday and many happy and productive years to come. So the zeta and L functions have played a very fundamental role in number theory. So today I will talk about this function in the set of the parallel set. We heard from this morning's talk that a lot of properties about the Riemann zeta function. So in particular, we know that after we analytically attenuate this zeta function to the whole complex plane, it has trivial zeros, the negative even integers. And the famous Riemann hypothesis says that all the non-trivial zeros are expected to lie on the line of symmetry that's a little part of S equal to 1/10. And another important zeta functions in I'll talk about is the several zeta function. So I'll start with the group SO2Z, which acts on the Poincaré upper plane by fractional linear transformation. So we can take a discrete torsion-free co-compact subgroup of SO2R and look at its orbit space. It turns out that because of the way we choose our group, this orbit space is a compact Riemann surface. And since the upper half plane is simply connected, and this group is torsion-free, so it is the fundamental group of this torsion. So what we are interested in is to count the geodesic cycles on this Riemann surface. But we'll count them up to equivalence. That means that we are going to ignore the starting point, but we will distinguish the two opposite orientations. So we call a cycle primitive if it is not obtained from a shorter cycle by repeating it more than once. So the equivalence classes of primitive geodesics are the primes for this manifold. So then all the interesting geodesics which will be counting will be either primes or prime powers. So they are nothing like P times Q, just P and the powers of P. So in 1956, Selberg introduced the Selberg zeta function, which counts the equivalence classes of the geodesic cycles. So we take the product of the primes. So each factor is 1 minus e to the minus length of the cycle times s. But then if we also include repeating this cycle, then we'll have the product I take from 0 to 2, and I change s to s plus 10. It turns out that this kind of geodesic cycles are in one-to-one correspondence with the conjugated classes of primitive elements of its fundamental group, gamma. So, and also this correspondence preserves the list. So we can restate this Selberg zeta function in terms of a conjugated classes of primitive elements. So on this Riemann surface, we have a Laplacian operator acting on the L2 functions of this surface. And this Laplacian operator has discrete spectrum, and they are all non-negative, and goes all the way to infinity. And Selberg showed that the non-trivial zeros of his zeta function actually can be expressed using the non-trivial eigenvalues, lambda, 1/2 plus minus root 1/2 minus lambda n. And even clearer way to see this connection is the result of Sarnak and Vorosh, which says that this Selberg zeta function is very closely related to the determinant function of Laplacian. So the difference is that there's some exponential function and a gamma function and a digamma function. So this part is independent of the group. But then the different factor is that this part, this function, raised to the power twice of genus minus 2. So exponent here gives a topological information of the ring surface. Then determinant of the Laplacian was defined, it's a little bit complicated to define it, but formally it has the spirit of taking the product of this lambda n minus s times 1 minus s. So there you can see that this non-trivial zeros are obtained from each factor by setting it equal to 0 and solving for s. This is what you get. So as you can see from here that when the eigenvalues are at least 1/4, then these non-trivial zeros will lie on the line where s equal to 1/2. So there are only at most finite and many eigenvalues which will be less than 1/4, which will make the Riemann hypothesis fail. And the famous 1/4 conjecture of Selberg says that if the group is a congruent subgroup, then all the non-trivial eigenvalues will be at least 1/4. So therefore, the Riemann hypothesis should hold. So now we'll go to the combinatorial side. Before I go there, let me go back to this setting for the Riemann surface. So we know that this upper plane can be viewed as a homogeneous space, as a PDO to R, mod out its maximal compact subgroup. So Ihara was looking at the Selberg's work, and his idea was that let's study what happens if we replace this field R by a chaotic field. So let's assume that F is a chaotic field with Q elements in its residue field. For instance, you can think of that as the field of the chaotic numbers. Then the residue field will have P elements, or it is the field of a Lorentz series with coefficients in the finite field of Q elements. In this case, the residue field will have Q elements. So therefore, we have this setting. We take PGO2F model by its maximum compact subgroup. And on the other side, we do the same thing. We take a discrete torsion-free co-compact subgroup of PGO2F. We model on the other side. So therefore, we get something which is a finite. So then, Ihara defines the data function for this finite, this set X gamma. So it has a form similar to the way that Selberg defined his data function. So it's the product over the conjugacy process of pre-field elements in the group gamma. But each factor has a different form because we are in the chaotic field case. So each factor is 1 over 1 minus u to the length of gamma. So you have to prove that this data function is a rational function, has many nice properties. So then the question is that, Selberg zeta function counts the geodesic cycles. Then what does the Ihara zeta function count? So then Sale observed that this part, PGO2F modeled by maximum compact subgroup, actually is a tree, which is a Q plus 1 regular tree. So then this X gamma, is a finite portion of this Q plus 1 regular tree. So it is a Q plus 1 regular graph. And the zeta function precisely counts the geodesic cycles in this graph. And therefore, when you see things this way, and Ihara's definition just works for all finite graphs. So let's take X to be a connected undirected finite graph. And just like before, So the primes will graph by equivalence classes of a primitive geodesic cycle. So then the Hara zeta function associated to a finite connected graph is an infinite product over the primes, 1 over 1 minus u raised to the length of 2 primes. And this infinite product, well, can be expressed as the exponential of the sum where each term here counts the number of closed geodesic cycles of the step. So you can see that this definition, well, is very much like the zeta function for curves over finite fields. That's exactly the same thing. And also, in this case, that this product over primes can also be expressed as a product over the conjugated classes of primitive elements from the fundamental group of the graph. Okay, so what kind of nice properties does the zeta function have? Now, if this graph happens to be regular, say each point has q plus 1 elements, then Ihara showed that this zeta function is actually a rational function. The numerator is 1 minus u squared raised to the Euler characteristic of the graph, and denominator is a determinant of identity minus adjacency operator, or adjacency matrix times u plus q u squared r. So we know that this adjacency matrix is a symmetric matrix with real entries. So it's all its eigenvalues are real. For regular graphs, the eigenvalues cross between q plus 1 and a minus of q plus 1. So the denominator can be expressed in terms of the product over the eigenvalues of the graph. So you can think of this zeta function here, the numerator here, the exponent here gives topological information, and denominator here gives the spectral information about the graph. So as a form, this thing looks exactly like the identity I showed you for the self of zeta function. And I want to draw your attention to the fact that the Ihara theorem was proved in 1968, and the similar result for the human surface was proved 19 years later. Okay, so, and also the Euler characteristic for graph actually is a negative integer, so, which means that the zeta function is really 1 over a polynomial in U. So therefore, we are interested in the distribution of the poles of the zeta function. So those poles coming from plus minus 1 from this factor here are the trivial poles. And also, where the eigenvalue lambdas are the trivial eigenvalue, namely plus minus of q plus 1, and they also contribute to trivial poles. And all the other poles coming from the non-trivial eigenvalues, we call that the non-trivial. So we say that the zeta satisfies the Riemann hypothesis if and only if all the non-trivial poles have the same absolute value. Okay. In this case, that the absolute value has to be q to the minus 1 half. So then when you go back and look at the expressions here, then this tells you that the zeta satisfies the Riemann hypothesis if and only if all the non-trivial eigenvalues will have absolute value bounded by twice root q. And such kind of graph is called a Lagrangian graph. So for a graph, its zeta function satisfies the Riemann hypothesis if and only if this graph is Lagrangian. So the meaning of the bound for this Lagrangian, the eigenvalues for a Lagrangian graph, so that's the interval from minus 2 root q to 2 root q, is the spectrum of its universal curve. So then Hashimoto looked at the Ihara zeta function and comes with another way to see that it's 1 over a polynomial. So we started with the graph which is undirected, Now, to each edge, we'll give two directions and define the adjacency of a directed edge. So we say that the out neighbor of the edge from U to V are the edges coming out of V, except that we do not allow it to return to U. So once we have these adjacency relations, we can express that using adjacency matrix T. Then Hashimoto observed that the trace of a T to the N is nothing but the number of geodesic cycles of length N. Okay. So if you call the zeta function, so this part is the trace of T to the N. Once you have that, immediately that you see that this zeta is actually 1 over the determinant of identity minus edge-adjacency operator. So this relation holds for graphs which are regular and irregular. And so then we can ask, well, how about the other side, the side that we saw of the Ihara's result for the graph which is not regular? Actually, there's also a similar expression. All it does is just that we place the last factor, which was qi times u squared, by the degree matrix minus identity. So we have this relationship, the two ways to express the Ihara zeta function. Okay. Now, if I think of a finite graph playing the role of a number field, and for number field we have absolute power group, and the corresponding role on the graph would be played by the fundamental group. So therefore, for each, if we take a finite dimensional representation of the fundamental group, we can define the Artinel function. So it's a product over the aggregated classes of primitive elements of 1 over determinant of identity minus the representation of the gamma times u to the length of gamma. So when this representation is a trivial representation, we get back to the zeta function. Otherwise, we have the Artinel function. So it's a result of Ihara, Hashimoto, and the Stark and Peres saying that the similar relations we saw before for the zeta function also holds for the Artinel function. Just that each matrix now has a size which is the original size times the dimension of the So next I want to talk about the distribution and the density of the primes in the graph. So first, two notations. The first is that, so we have this prime, so we look at the length of the primes and the GCD of the length, we call that a delta. So that each prime will have the length which is some integer multiple of delta. Another quantity is that, and look at this edge adjacency matrix, and look at its eigenvalues in absolute value, and take the maximal one. That's called the lambda x. So 1 over lambda x is the pole of the zeta function closest to the origin. So actually, lambda itself is an eigenvalue. It's an eigenvalue of. So the prime number theorem proved by Hashimoto says that if we count the number of primes whose length is n times the GCD, then one can express that in terms of lambda and the delta this way. And if I look at the primes whose length is strictly less than n times delta, and that number actually is a fraction of the number of. And another important theorem in the number theory is that if I have a finite extension, a finite Galois extension of a number field, then there's a triple power density theorem. And we can ask a similar thing for the graphs. So I take a finite unramified normal cover and with a Galois group G. So in this case, for each prime of X, we can associate a conjugated class, which is called a Frobenius. So for each prime, we associate a country basic class of the Galois group. So then this is another way. If I start with any country basic class of the Galois group, I can collect all the primes whose frobenius is this given country basic class. So the game we are playing here is that the group G is finite, so there are only finitely many country basic classes. But in general, that has infinitely many primes. So we want to know how these primes are distributed among them, these country basic classes. So Hashimoto and Stark-Perez prove that the Frobenius country basic classes are uniformly distributed in the Galois group with respect to the Dirichlet density. Sorry. So the Dirichlet density means that you consider this series U to the length of the primes, or the primes whose frobenius is given the conjugate class. You compare that to log of zeta, and you let U approach to the closest pole on the left-hand side. And this limit is the size of conjugacy class over the size of the group. And for number fields, it's known that Chebotaro's density theorem also holds for natural density. So it's natural to ask, well, whether this is also true for graphs. So Hashimoto had only published the result to say that yes, it does, but then we found a gap. So the truth is that the natural density holds if and only if the GCD of the primes upstairs for the current graph Y is the same as the GCD of the primes downstairs. And the result of Stark-Perez tells you that GCD of the primes upstairs is either the same as the GCD of primes downstairs or twice of that. And the both cases do occur. Therefore, the natural density does not always hold, depending on the situation. So next week, we'll venture to the higher dimensional case. So it has been if we think of a finite graph as a one-dimensional sequential complex, then for over 40 years, people are trying to find a good definition for the zeta functions of higher-dimensional sequential complex. So here I will show you two such examples where this higher-dimensional sequential complex comes from taking the finite quotient of a building. So we look at the case of that Ihara looked at. So that tree attached associated to PGO2F is actually the Bruhati's building, or the attached to SO2. So I just go to the next one, consider the Bruhati's building attached to SO3. And so it is a sequential complex. So the vertices are the equivalent classes of the three-dimensional lattices. And the highest dimension will be a triangle. Each face is a triangle, and it's called a chamber in the language of building. So three vertices form a chamber if they can be represented by lattices which are closely apart. So then any two vertices in the chamber will be adjacent. So let me just show you by this graph. So it's known that the building is obtained by taking apartments and gluing the apartments together. Each apartment is a Euclidean space. For the case of a tree, each apartment is just an infinite path, infinite on both ends. Sorry, for PGO3, then each apartment is a plane. And we said that each chamber is a triangle, so it actually is an equilateral triangle. So each apartment is tiled by equilateral triangles, the way you see here. And then you glue this kind of pattern together along, well, some portions of the triangles. So if I take any point in the apartment, so I look at the edges coming out of this point, there are two kinds. So one kind is called the edges of type 1, another kind is called the edges of type 2. And the endpoints of type 1 edges and type 2 edges are described by the heck operators, A1 and A2. So the group PGO3F, and X on the lattices, so X on the vertices, and it preserves adjacency. And it turns out that the vertices can be parameterized by the coset of maximum compact subgroup. So if I take PGO3F divided out by maximum compact subgroup, so that part represents the vertices of building, I can think of that as a building. So I can take discrete quotient three co-compact subgroup, map out on the other side, so I get a finite quotient, and this one inherits a situational complex structure. It's a two-dimensional. So now we want to define the zeta function for this quotient. Here is the key. Well, just like what happened for the graphs, we want to count the geodesic cycles of given length. So a geodesic cycle in the quotient lived up to a geodesic in an apartment. This apartment has Euclidean metric. So a geodesic is a straight line. So it turns out that a good way, a good choice of a geodesic cycle is that the straight lines through the vertices, but they only use the edges we have in the building, so which lies in the one skeleton of the building. So which means that the path either always uses edges of type 1 or always uses edges of type 2. So if you define the zeta function this way, and for the edges of type 1, each step has length 1, with type 2, each step has length has 2, and this kind of zeta function will come out as a very nice property. So the first expression is just similar to what we saw from the Hashimoto case. So the first quotient is described the cycles of type 1, the second one is the cycles of type 2. And the more interesting part is that it has similar expression like the Pythagoras. So the numerator is 1 minus u cubed to the Euler characteristic. And the denominator has two parts. The first part used the two Heck operators. And because this is a two-dimensional case, we also have the second part, which comes from geodesic paths coming from by the chambers. And we have the similar situation that the complex is a Ramjian complex if and only if the zeta function satisfies the Riemann hypothesis. So I like it's also similar to the case of graphs. We have the RTL function attached to attached to finite quotients of the building of PGO3. So if I take a finite dimensional representations, I can define the RTL function, and we have similar expressions. Okay. So this identity is proved using cohomology method, and while the previous identity, well, there are three proofs, but the one is by counting the geodesic cycle, the second using representation theory, they are very difficult to be used to establish identity for the RTL function. And another two-dimensional complex is the building attached to the group SD4. So let me just show you that for SD4, it's also building a two-dimensional. Each plane now is tiled by isosceles right triangle. So only in this case, the situation is more complicated. There are two kinds of vertices. The black ones are called the special vertices, and the red ones are called the non-special vertices. And the edges of type 1 are the slanted kind. Edges of type 2 are the horizontal and the vertical kind. And the group PGSD4 acts transitively on the special vertices, and that the special vertices can be parameterized by the process of the standard maximum complex approval. So if we do a similar thing, take a discrete Cauchy-free co-complex group of PGSD4F, and model, the building model by gamma, we define data function in a similar way. So we can have a nice expression. One is that Hashimoto type, the first factor describes the cycles of type 1, the second is the cycles of type 2, and we also have expression which is of power like. So the denominator here uses the two Hecker operators, and also we have another factor which is the adjacency of the chambers. And the numerator is similar to before, except it's more complicated. We have one extra factor. So I just want to point out that 1 over the determinant involving the Hecker operators is called Langlands L function attached to GSD4. Except that there are two standard kinds of Langlands L functions. So this is the kind is so-called attached to the spin representation. And this, so this kind of L function shows up in this kind of data function we described. And there's another Langlands L function which is attached to so-called standard representation. That thing has degree 5. So it turns out that that L function also shows up in the zeta. Okay. So in that case, we have to count the cycles in different ways. So for the cycles of type 2, we want to each step as length 1. And the cycles of type 1, we count it twice. So if we do that, then we can also have the Langlands L function of associated to the standard representation shows up. As you can see that the numerator gets more complicated. But anyhow, this is explicit.
Close small expression. So
I end my pocket. Thank you. Any questions? Yes. What is PGSD4 hat?
This is the dual group. I don't want to mention that. That's the reason why I don't talk about it.
Other questions?
Am I one to
Yes. I just wanted to show there's a deep connection between combinatorial objects and the number theory. That's my point.
Thank you very much.
I'm not loud enough. I just want to warn